Here's a story with a happy ending. It's a story about how people sometimes do pay attention to the mistakes they've made. It's a story about how close we came to losing the living symbol of this country, the American bald eagle, and how the American people brought the eagle back. Just 25 years ago, the bald eagle was at the edge of extinction in the lower 48 states, a celebrity on the newly written endangered species list. Well, it wasn't easy, and it wasn't overnight, but through the persistent work of experts and volunteers, the eagle has come back to communities across the country. This story comes from those communities and the people who took up the fight and continue the struggle to bring their eagles back. Why do they do it? For themselves? Maybe. For their children? For sure.
God in heaven, hear my prayer. If you are still above, send the children hopes and dreams. I'll ask of you to conquer all their fears and let them soar like eagles across the trail of tears.
I'm Billy Ray Cyrus, and I'm proud to bear witness to the return of the American Eagle. Each spring, for the past few years, gifts have been arriving here in New England. This is a four-week-old bald eagle chick, part of a new generation, the first to be born here in a very long time. After nearly 90 years, eagles have come back to Massachusetts. The reason for the eagle's disappearance here is a common story, all too common. As people settled and cleared the land, eagles retreated, and as development intensified, eagles nearly disappeared. Conservationists across the country watched it happen. Ed Clark, vice chairman of the National Wildlife Federation, saw it happen in Virginia.
As we demanded more and more from the land, we began to use more and more extreme measures, including very chemically intensive farming measures. And some of those chemicals were devastating. DDT in particular was an insecticide used indiscriminately for all types of insect control. But unfortunately, that chemical built up in the environment and eventually infiltrated all aspects of the food chain. And the eagles, being at the top of their food chain, really are the organisms that collected and concentrated this chemical. And that caused devastating effects to their population.
From the time Europeans first arrived on this continent through the end of World War II, bald eagles and other birds of prey declined pretty quickly in numbers, but not like the devastation brought on by DDT. DDT wasn't always thought to be an awful thing. During the Second World War, DDT was used everywhere to kill insect-borne diseases like malaria and typhus. Some thought that DDT won the war in the Pacific. And when the war was over, we brought DDT home. There were all kinds of claims about this miracle chemical.
Epidemic. San Antonio health authorities attacked germ carriers on a citywide front. With war-discovered DDT in special sprayers, sections of the city are literally fogged with the insecticide. Every suspected spot is sprayed. Literally tons of DDT are used on this dread disease that attacks our young. Again, war, destructive and terrible, contributes one of its discoveries to save life.
Eagles, at the top of the food chain, were eating animals that ate other animals, each in turn concentrating the DDT, so that the fish the eagles ate were pure poison. What did DDT do to eagles? It caused the thinning of shells so their eggs were crushed. It caused infertility and death. And Deagle's problems didn't end with the banning of DDT in 1973. Other pollutants, such as PCBs, are still traveling up that same food chain, causing birth defects, such as this crossed bill. How bad did it get? Some say that when Columbus arrived in the New World, there were 100,000 eagles in the lower 48 states. By 1973, there were no more than 400 breeding pairs. When Congress passed legislation in the mid-70s, like the Endangered Species Act, the Clean Air and Clean Water Acts, things started to change. All we needed was a new attitude, but we had a ways to go. As much as we revered the symbol, we feared the bird. In 1907, Thomas Edison portrayed the eagle as the jaws of its day, carrying away a small child and attacking his father. It never happened. It never could happen, and yet the myth, even in more recent films, continues. But eagles have been accused of carrying away livestock and family pets and even children. They've been hunted with rifles and intentionally poisoned. They were the symbol of America and public enemy number one.
Please, bird, don't hurt me!
You put me on the ground, you damn dirty bird!
Who knows if eagles have a sense of humor? Can't see much reason why they should. This past summer, I went to Southeast Washington, D.C., one of the toughest neighborhoods in America, where I met a bunch of young men and women who were turning things around. These guys are the Eagle Corps, part of the Earth Conservation Corps, AmeriCorps volunteers who earn a bit of cash and a lot of scholarship money for college and tech schools. For the past 6 weeks, they've been raising eagle chicks, and today's the day to set them free. I'd heard that some of these kids thought I wasn't the real Billy Ray Cyrus. I might have to go a ways to prove them wrong.
How you doing? What's your name?
Keyonce.
You ain't the real Keyonce, are you? Be honest about it. Is she the real deal?
No.
I thought it was an imposter. How are you doing?
Fine. I know your dance watch.
Don't tell my heart, my icky, breaky heart. I just don't think it understands. And if you tell my heart, my icky, breaky heart, he might blow up and kill this man. All right, yeah.
So once our credentials were clear, I learned about a bunch of projects these kids were doing, like building bat houses from recycled wood found on the streets of D.C., an environmentally friendly way to control mosquitoes in the area. But we were here today to release eagle chicks.
So what do you think's going to happen when we turn them loose down here? What do you think they're going to do?
I think first of all, they're going to survey their new territory because they were from Wisconsin. Once they get a feel for what's around here, then, I mean, they're going to stay around, especially LB. You know, LB is one of the eagles that we named after a Corps member who got killed this year.
LB stands for?
Leroy Brown.
What happened to Leroy Brown?
Well, Leroy, he got caught up in around the way with a dispute with this guy, and the guy came back and had a gun and unfortunately shot him.
Got caught.
Shot him 5 times.
Oh,
it's said that here in Southeast D.C., where street violence has become epidemic, 2 men in 10 won't live to see their 25th birthday.
Were you close with Leroy Brown?
Well, yeah, I was like his cousin. I grew up with him from baby. We were babies together.
But you know, if Leroy Brown was coming back, don't you think Leroy Brown would want you guys to stay strong now?
Yeah, oh yeah. Most definitely.
I think he would, man.
Yeah.
I was struck by something in these young men. It was their deep reverence for life. Maybe it comes from seeing so many lives lost. Eagle chicks also face long odds, but these kids were doing all they could to give the chicks the best possible start. The Eagle Corps had raised their chicks in something called a hacking box. Hacking boxes were the key to bringing eagles back. The idea of hacking began more than 20 years ago in upstate New York under the direction of biologist Peter Nye.
DDT had been banned in the earlier 1970s nationally. The Bald Eagle Act had been passed, so eagles were protected, their nests were protected. And we thought the conditions were suitable once again for bald eagles, so really all that remained was the question, how can we physically accomplish a restoration of eagles?
With eagles all but gone in the Northeast, Peter Nye and the state team traveled to Alaska, where they gathered chicks from wild nests and brought them back to New York.
Nothing had ever been done like that with eagles before, so really it was a kind of a novel experiment to see, could you release young bald eagles in the absence of parent birds and really count on or rely on them achieving their own survivorship and adulthood later on at about 5 years of age.
Over a period of 12 years, the New York team released over 200 eagles. Similar programs in 12 other states gathered birds from Alaska and Canada and released them in their own backyards. Throughout the 1980s, eagles came back strong.
It feels tremendous. I mean, not very many people, I'm afraid, get the opportunity to say, you know, I made a difference in society and in the natural world, and this project really did something unique, and it has happened, and it's been successful, and it's a great feeling.
Once these eagles began to build their own nests and reproduce in their new homes, reintroductory hacking programs were no longer necessary. This is the last year the Eagle Corps will release chicks here in Washington.
Do it, Edward. Set him free, buddy. Let it go.
The Eagle Corps asked me and Ed Clark to join them as they opened a new world to these chicks. After the hack box was opened, we waited for the eagles to take off. We waited and we waited.
Whenever they get any kind of change in their enclosure, a lot of times they'll just kind of freeze up.
And finally, we figured the chicks would be more likely to fly if we left the area. So we got back in our van and drove to the other side of the river. On the way, we talked about music and other things.
I'm very serious about music. You know, I just love music. It's in my everyday life. I mean, what was like your motivating factor
My heart. And that's, you know, my heart was telling me, hey, there's my bus right there. Perfect timing.
Hey.
Y'all want to get on it and ride over?
Yeah.
It's time for letting go. We're going to let Leroy Brown go today, man.
Oh, I got this.
Yeah, come on up and copy the chair.
It's time for letting go. We can't hide what we both know. Ooh, the hurt grows. Every time I think it's over.
So in the time it takes to make a new friend, we were across the river, where we settled in and waited some more while the eagles tested their wings and thought about freedom.
Deep inside, the time is telling me it's time for letting go.
It'll take these chicks 5 years to reach adulthood, to really look like bald eagles, with a white head and white tail. Life in the wild can be harsh, but you can't help but hope for the best for LB and the other chicks. A long and healthy life.
I just can't keep holding on. Holding on and holding on.
Sing that song good.
I love music.
Man, you sing music.
Each spring, members of the Massachusetts Division of Fish and Wildlife visit eagle nests. At the Quabbin Reservoir, there are five active nests built by eagles released here in the 1980s in a state hacking program. Some of the same team that released those birds have come back to check on the young of the year, to give physical exams and to band the chicks.
Yep.
Typically, the eagle parents don't seem to mind. Some species, like peregrine falcons, can get really hostile.
Today's date?
Diane Davis, veterinary technician, does the physicals.
Do they ever dive at the nest if you're in there?
Parents? No. They just call a little bit, then they'll go sit in a tree and just watch. And what we do is we take the babies, put them back in the nest, and give them a fish. Parents come back in. Where did this fish come from? Junior can't fly. Nice.
Looks like one chick's coming down.
Eagle chicks grow incredibly fast, so the state team, led by Diane's husband, Bill Davis, have to time their visits perfectly.
They're old enough to have some fluff and some feathers to protect them and keep them warm, but they're also young enough where they're not going to step out of the nest when you go up and approach the nest top.
Chicks are given a thorough physical. Blood is taken to see if they carry any pollution load. So far, the Quabbin chicks look very healthy.
A scab. Oh, that is. There. No, you don't want to eat that. It was covering your nostril. Oh, yeah, you couldn't breathe out of that side, could you?
When the exam's complete, the chicks are banded on both legs. Bill Davis explains.
Silver band is the federal band that has an 8-digit identifying number, and this will go into a national database, so we'll know exactly who this bird is. And the gold band is a field-readable band, so if we see this bird in the future with a good spotting scope, we may be able to know exactly who this bird is and then learn something about its survival rate. So we'll put one on each leg.
One more? Come on.
Okay, coming up, Mike.
The whole process takes about a half hour, at least when things go well. 20 miles away, at another site, on the Connecticut River, it's a different story. Just getting to the nest takes a radical approach and some patience.
I guess I've got to really give it a whirl.
Tom French, field biologist and amateur archer, had to get a line over a high branch in a cottonwood tree just to get at this nest.
I hit the nest. Don't kill a bird.
No, I don't want to kill a bird.
That's where I want it, right there.
When he finally got up there, he brought a camera with him.
Okay, here I am. Okay, there's a law enforcement boat.
We've got our environmental police with us standing by on the river. In the event one of the chicks backs off to the edge of the nest or gets blown out as we approach.
Each approach to an eagle's nest is unique, but for Tom French, this one was a little more unique.
I've never been into an eagle nest where the chicks were actually aggressive. Usually bald eagle chicks are very laid back and non-offensive.
Now let's see if we can go up and see some eagles.
They were so large, and really what happened in this case, I put the net over the head of the first one, and as it flung one wing open, it sort of bumped the second.
One way to go. Hanging on the outer edge, Tom.
Seven-week-old chicks are too young to fly. Every instinct is telling them to hold on.
Oh, yeah. Nice job. You want to send them in the net?
So the day ended well. The two chicks here, just 3 weeks older than the Quabbin chicks, were nearly twice as big. They were given a complete physical. They were banded, and they were sent home with some fish. But what happens when an animal is hurt?
Okay, great. Well, let me take him on into the back.
Well, if you're anywhere near the Shenandoah Valley, you call the Wildlife Center of Virginia. Ed Clark is the director of the center, one of the leading wildlife hospitals in the country. The Wildlife Center sees all kinds of animals. They see more than 2,500 patients a year, from chimney swifts to bears to bald eagles. This is Skyler, a southern bald eagle and a permanent resident of the Wildlife Center. Years ago, Schuyler's right wing was burned by a power line and partially amputated. Like many non-releasable animals, Schuyler has earned his living in outreach programs, traveling to schools and special events.
Well, I'm an eagle.
A couple of weeks ago, he cut his leg. Wildlife vet Ned Gentz checks the progress.
About one more week of bandaging and he's going to be good as new.
Routine work like this isn't the routine. The center has to be able to handle any native wildlife problem.
Okay, so have you tried to feed him anything?
Well, anytime the phone rings, we really never know what to expect. So last Monday, we got a call from someone who had found a big brown bird, looked like an eagle. So they thought it was a brown eagle, and it had some sort of stuff all over its feathers. Well, the stuff turned out to be fecal material, and it was indeed all over its feathers. This bird was plastered. He had been fished out of a sewage settling pond. And when he was brought in, you could smell him long before you could see him. And the staff needed a very special dedication to be able to administer treatment to that particular bird.
All he really needed was a couple of baths. After the bird was cleaned up and checked out, he was ready for release. The Wildlife Center team drove to the Caledon Natural Area along the tidal Potomac River, where there's a summer colony of bald eagles.
All right. Hey, bud. There we go. Yes, it's too bad. Too bad. Oh, what a thing to do to an eagle.
Before his release, he was given state and federal bans.
To an eagle. Perfect. Got him.
Okay.
Got his head?
Got his head.
This is the moment that counts, where we pay our respects to another species, where we say we've done our best for you. It's really very easy.
Give us a count.
In count of three, gentlemen. One, two, three.
Then it's a matter of just pointing him in the right direction and launching him to the sky. And as Murphy's Law of Wildlife works, he immediately turned around and went in the wrong direction.
We'll give him a minute before we climb the tree. There he goes.
When you release animals like this, they never say thank you. But when you get a chance to release an animal and then really watch it be free and watch it revel in its newfound independence, it's a very, very special gift. And it's the type of thing that makes it crystal clear why you do this for a living.
In the village of Turner's Falls in western Massachusetts, there's a new community of eagle experts who've become very attached to one nesting pair. There's nothing small about this group, 30,000 people, pretty much the entire town keep an eye on this nest. All you have to do is switch the cable box to Channel 6, the Eagle Channel, now housed in the old fire station. Ron Bosch is the director of Montague Community Television, and he keeps the Eagle Channel up and running.
I think some people would laugh at it if we just use regular VCRs. You know, it's a very simple system, but it does do the job.
Among their channels, Montague TV offers full-time live coverage of the local eagle nests. This spring, viewers followed the progress of a nesting pair as they rebuilt their nest, laid two eggs, and recently hatched an eagle chick. Even though an eagle pair had been nesting here for nearly 10 years, townspeople didn't pay too much attention till they saw the birds on TV.
There's something about the fact that it's in people's own backyard, that it's right there, that they can actually go outside and see those eagles flying overhead. It's like they really consider it their eagles.
Everyone in town learned something about these birds, maybe not as much as Miss Kosterman's second grade class.
What did we learn from watching the Eagle Channel on TV? Who can tell us? I'll call and everybody just got their hand up, okay? Caitlin.
That one of the eaglets hatched, but the other one didn't.
Spencer, what did you learn?
The nest is 8 feet wide and 6 feet deep.
6 feet deep. Okay, Spencer. Very good. Molly.
Eagle's favorite time the E is in the early morning and late afternoon.
Very good.
So, from classrooms to bar rooms to laundromats to showrooms, the Turner's Falls Eagles had found an audience.
Good, oh, we come in here every noontime, watch them, yeah. Oh, it's really interesting. It's great that we come down and watch it. What do you think, Sam?
Oh, we love them. They're beautiful.
But mostly, it was in people's homes. 10,000 families called these eagles their own and watched carefully as this chick grew up. But then, things went very wrong. Carolyn Boardman, who directs the Wildlife Visitors Center at Turner's Falls, followed the events of the day very closely.
Well, Sunday afternoon was very lovely. I mean, blue sky and a gentle wind like it is now, but the tornado watch, tornado warning reports were coming through on the radio, and so the sky got very dark and the winds picked up, and I lost sight of the nest on the cove. The wind kicked up and brought heavy rains, and then I was not able to see the nest at all. However, the camera was still rolling, they were broadcasting from the island, and I decided to just, you know, press record so I could get the whole thing on videotape.
You know, it's really amazing how nature really works, and have faith that it knows better than anybody of what ought to go down or not.
Part of the tree above the nest had broken off and fallen and hit the camera pole. And because the metal bent very slowly, the camera came down slowly, and as it did, it fell back away from the nest, giving a wider, ever wider and wider view of the nest until the whole nest was in the picture. And at that point, we saw the female eagle had been startled off the nest, and she was actually above the nest in the air for a few seconds, and then came back down, pinned the eaglet down underneath her as best she could. The eaglet seemed to be struggling and jumping up and down a little bit, but yet what was the most exciting part of it was that mother bird on top of her baby, and the tree, you know, rocking back and forth, the gusty winds, but the bird just pinning it down, and the public service announcement scrolling down the side.
The nest survived the storm, even though the camera pole was lost. But the community was so committed to their eagles that volunteers took shifts watching the nest for the next several months.
Would you believe it? There's the eagle. Wow.
Although chicks and other nests were lost in that same storm, the Turner's Falls chick survived and thrived through the summer and left her parents in the late fall. I waited till mid-July, the hottest day of the year, to visit the eagle population along the James River in Virginia, just upstream from Chesapeake Bay. It was 100 degrees at 8 o'clock in the morning, and the only people heading out on the river were a couple of dedicated field biologists and a crazy country singer. I was the guest of Mitchell Bird and Brian Watts of the Center for Conservation Biology at the College of William and Mary. Dr. Bird had dedicated his life to preserving and protecting eagles and all wildlife along these waterways.
Dr. Bird, may I ask, at what stage did you decide this is what you want to do with your life?
Well, I was interested in birds, as was Brian when we were little kids. I think 12 years old or so, right, Brian? And it's just an interest that never waned. Also, with a name like Bird, I would almost have to be interested.
Well, there you go. That's right.
Although eagles had come back strong here on the James River, it took some practice to spot them. Dr. Bird offered some tips.
This bluff right up here is a good spot. Eagles like to perch along the shoreline in good exposed trees because they do what we call perch feeding. They'll spot something out in the river from a high exposed perch and they'll go out and grab it and then come back and eat it.
Oh, I can see where that would be a big asset to sit up in that tree and look down in the water.
Yeah. Well, we frequently see them sitting there and all of a sudden they'll take out across the river and fly out halfway across this river and drop down and pick up a dead fish. It's pretty amazing.
Will they eat a dead fish just as well as a live fish?
Yeah, I think they probably eat more dead fish up here than they do live fish.
So they're somewhat of a scavenger too.
Yeah. It's probably what led Benjamin Franklin to suggest a wild turkey would make a better national emblem.
Oh, no.
Lucky for the bald eagle, Ben Franklin's proposal to have the turkey as the national symbol never caught on. The James River is an active waterway with a deep water channel for ships dredged all the way to Richmond. Eagles seemed able to share the shoreline with all kinds of development, at least so far.
What would this land have looked like in the early 1700s, and what would you speculate would have been the eagle population then?
This land was basically, of course, all forested. And I'm sure there were a lot of eagles along these waterways. We certainly know that it declined precipitously. It was down to about 66 known pairs. And there has recovered to, you know, well over 500 pairs. And we may be reaching a maximum population at this point in time, or certainly will be reaching it in the not too distant future.
28.
I think you're off by about half.
You think so?
Yeah.
How many you got?
I'd say more like 50 or so, wouldn't you, bro?
Yeah, we've seen about 50 or so.
We've seen 50 within an hour's time. That's great.
The eagle population here has made a dramatic recovery in 20 years, but increased numbers don't guarantee the future. I asked Dr. Bird about the legal status of eagles.
Mr. Bird, how do you feel about them taking the eagle off the endangered species list?
Well, from the standpoint of the population increase, I think this is probably a reasonable thing to do. But in terms of the habitat loss that's occurring here in Chesapeake Bay, it probably isn't a good thing to do. And I think a more prudent thing would be to keep it as a threatened list for at least another 4 or 5 years until we could determine what the rate of habitat loss is really going to be. This is one of the more rapidly growing areas in the country, this Chesapeake Bay watershed. And most people want to live on or near the water. So they're occupying shoreline habitats that are quite important for eagles at a rate that's probably, very unrealistic.
So habitat is key. Ed Clark agrees.
These birds are moving into available habitat, but very soon that habitat's going to be used up. And as people move in, the eagles, simply by virtue of their nature, move out. And unfortunately, we're making more and more people all the time, and we're not making more and more habitat. So that's one of the things that we need to keep in mind as we try to balance the abundance of human life with the quality of human life. If we are to enjoy the things that make this area a wonderful place in which to live, we need to make the decisions that are mindful of the other animals with which we share this ecosystem.
Well, in Massachusetts, maybe they're figuring it out. At least commercial development can coexist, even thrive, with wildlife conservation. Here's Eric Palola.
I think what's interesting about the Quabbin story is that
you have two interesting historical trends. One is that they've been logging for over 30 years. The other is that they've been working to reintroduce eagles for at least 20 years and showing positive results on both sides. But as well, the kind of economic stability that goes with having a harvesting program that continually provides wood to the local economy, but not doesn't get into the boom and bust sort of cycle that we've seen, or the downward spiral from harvesting too much of the good material and leaving too little for future harvesting cycles.
Eric Palola works for the National Wildlife Federation and directs the Smartwood Forest Certification Program. Jamie French, a second-generation timberman, is president of Northland Forest Products. The environmentalist and industrialist have found that they can help each other out. Smartwood certifies that the harvest and manufacture of wood products has no adverse effects on the land, the wildlife, or the people. And Northland realizes that the Smartwood stamp offers substantial value added to their products. It seems to work. Now, if we can only get developers and human residents to move away from the water's edge, we'll give the eagles a chance. For cars, it's Detroit. For guitar pickers, it's Nashville. For eagles, it's right here. This is the Chilkat River Valley in southeast Alaska, and you can see more eagles here in 1 hour than you'll see in a lifetime in the lower 48 states. Not many of these birds live here year-round. Most are just passing through. Some have come from 1,000 miles away. They gather here each year for the late salmon run on the Chilkat River. And with the eagles comes the Eagle Survey Team, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Biologist Mike Jacobson and Jack Hodges, and State Park Manager Bill Zack. They divide the valley into a grid and count as fast as they can. Today, the total was 1,800 eagles in a little more than an hour. In mid-November, they might count 4,000. Bill Zack explains why they're all here.
During the summer, we have too much volume of water coming in here to percolate out. And during the winter, it'll warm up. So I've been out here when it was minus 40 degrees. All the other rivers are frozen over, with the exception of this one, because of that warm percolating water coming up into the Chilkat River.
Wow.
So between the warm percolation and the late run of chum salmon, that's why we have the eagles gathering here in these numbers.
So the warm water brings the salmon by the millions, and the salmon bring the eagles by the thousands. There's a unique opportunity for these birds to bulk up before the long winter. You can see the eagles doing things you never imagined. You see them feeding, fighting, flying, and, well, I asked Bill Zack about what I hadn't seen.
What is the mating ritual?
Well, you'll actually, a common misconception is they mate while they're in the air tumbling, but I mean, when you stop to think about that, that's not really possible. But that is part of the courting ritual, is grabbing locking talons and falling through the air.
Eagles have been seen tumbling through the air like this for thousands of feet. Sometimes they don't let go, but mostly they pull up just before it's too late. It kind of reminded me of something humans do.
We used to do that when I was in high school.
There you go, yeah, right.
Yeah.
I don't remember falling through the air, though. It felt like it.
To see eagles everywhere, after having a hard time spotting them on the James River, to feel so much of the natural world after wondering what the Chesapeake looked like in the early 1700s, I found a truth here that went beyond words. What was the lesson to take away from this place? I wasn't going to try to figure it out on my own. I brought along my friend, Ed Clark.
So what's it like for a conservationist like yourself to be up here in this part of the country?
It's really inspirational to come to a place and see how perfect nature can be, and then I guess head back down to the lower 48 and try to take what we've got left and put back what we've lost and protect what we still have.
It does give you some hope, doesn't it?
Well, you can't be in the environmental community and be working in wildlife conservation unless you're basically an optimist. The bald eagle is a really good example of a species that was at the brink of extinction, and through the Endangered Species Act and the work of a number of national conservation organizations and the government and the private sector, that species is back and is about to really make its full recovery.
There's a rhythm to life here. The slap of a fin, the beat of a wing. It's a precious rhythm.
The eagle to our people and our native people around here is a symbol of strength, and just the strength of the bird means a lot.
Down by the Chilcat River, I met Donald Hotch, better known as Bosch. Bosch is a Tlingit Indian and a member of the Klukwan Tribal Council. Bosch says the Tlingits have always been here since time began. Native people and eagles shared the bounty of this land for thousands of years. In fact, a special relationship between eagles and Native Americans is recognized by our government. Under the laws that protect the bald eagle, only American Indian tribal members can possess any part, feather or bone, of an eagle. Klukwan means the village that's always been here. Bosch invited me into the village, to the Alaskan Native Sisterhood Hall, where we traded a few songs.
You ready? Okay, you ready? Don't tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, I just don't think you'd understand. And if you tell my heart, my achy, breaky heart, he might blow up and kill this man. Ooh, woo!
Billy Ray, and we sang a couple Indian songs. We danced the first one, and then I invited Billy Ray to come in and dance. He put on a good show for the rest of us, and the people here really enjoyed seeing him come out there to dance too when he went up there. I presented Billy Ray with a picture of myself dancing, and I presented him also with eagle feathers, and he couldn't take it with him because of the laws that cover those eagle feathers.
If I left here with these feathers, perhaps I too would be endangering the life of an eagle somewhere else. And I wanted to ask you the favor of, can I keep my feathers here?
To see Billy Ray and others taking care of the eagles is, a great thing that anybody could do, is try to preserve what we have now instead of watching it disappear and say we should have when it's all gone.
So it's a happy ending for the eagles, but the story's not over. With every ending, there's a new beginning. The future is up to us. The return of the eagle has just begun.
God in heaven, hear my prayer. If you are still able, send the children hopes and dreams, and lots of love. For this I only ask of you to conquer all their fears. Let them soar like eagles across. drops a trail of tears.